from our last videos of the playlist, once you have the understanding of why we wanted to use a hardware description language like VHDL for designing our digital systems and FPGAs or ASICs, we need to start with the basics of creating a VHDL design. So today we will be creating a basic VHDL module, including the interface and the functional description. You will be needing two main items for creating a design in VHDL. First is to define all the inputs and outputs of the design. We call this interface of our module or digital system. So we need to write a VHDL code for all the inputs and outputs of our digital system to tell the tool about the interface of our module. The second item we need to define is the functionality of our digital system. So in this section, you will write a VHDL code to define what you want it to get from your digital system and how it will be achieved. This can be the behavior definition from the sequential statements or the structure design, or can be the set of concurrent statements. Once you complete these two basic needs, you will have a complete VHDL design for your digital system. In VHDL, we define the interface using the entity and we define the functional description using the architecture. Let's understand the entity first. As I said, it's the interface of our module, which means entity has the information of all the inputs and outputs of our design. Entity is like defining a signals that are used for input and output of a digital system. So we write the VHDL code to define those signals. And once we have created the entity, we then describe the behavior of our design in VHDL architecture. Although the architecture is a separate design unit, but it is always associated with an entity, and any signal defined in the entity will be visible in the architecture and can be used anywhere inside the architecture. We normally be defining the entity with the symbol like this, where the box is our VHDL module which we are designing, and those lines connected with the module are called the signals. These signals can be inputs or outputs of the module. Lines in the left are normally inputs of the module, and lines to the right are normally the outputs of your module. In the last video, we taken an example of a simple multiplexer to understand the VHDL design tools and the design flow. So let's use the same example today. So for this multiplexer, we would have three inputs. These are input A, input B, and input select. And we have one output, that is D out. In VHDL, we require to use text to define the entity of our module. However, some tools have the capability to write the text for your entity by their own. So you only need to tell the interface of your design in GUI, but eventually you had to learn these text descriptions of your entity and the interface. So we start by using the keyword entity followed by the name of your entity. In our case, we named it mux and then type is and follow it with the port list. Port list is used to list all the signals which are inputs or the outputs of your module. So we write port and then open bracket to start listing all your signals. To define those signals, first we name the signal, then we press the colon key and then tell the direction of the signal. Either it is input to the module or output from the module. And in the last, specify the signal type and terminate with the semicolon key. Let's see it in our example. First is signal A, so type A and then press the colon key, then type in for the input signal and then enter the data type of the signal A, which is bit in our case. Bit is the binary data type that supports values 0 and 1. And in the last, terminate this line with the semicolon symbol. Similarly, we will continue to list more inputs for input B and input select in the same way. Some of you who are little familiar with writing the entity may use std underscore logic as data type in place of bit here, but that is fine too. Both will work here. Now, once all the inputs are defined, Let's define the output. Our output is dout, so type dout, then press the colon key and then type out, because dout is the output type signal. Then enter the data type, that is bit, and then close the bracket after listing the last signals of the port list, and then enter the semicolon to terminate the port list definition. This close bracket and semicolon denotes that all the port list of your module is defined. This is very important to know that when you are defining your last signal in the port list, then you need to close the bracket first and then enter the semicolon. Many of the newcomers in VHDL do this mistake, that while defining the last signal, they do enter the semicolon before closing the bracket. So make sure when you're defining your last signal, you need to close the port list bracket first and then enter the semicolon. Finally, we finish our entity by using the AND statement followed by the name of the entity and then the semicolon. So it is the AND marks and then semicolon. Okay, we just had written the entity for our first digital system. Let's have a quick look of the entity syntax in VHDL. This is just for reference what we did. We used keyword entity followed by the entity name and then write is, then list all the input and output signals in the port list. For that, we used port keyword and listed all the signals inside the brackets and in the last terminated with the semicolon. Finally, we used the keyword AND followed by the entity name and entered semicolon. Just like any formal syntax of a language, there are specific identification of each item. Like we have here, marks is an identifier for defining the entity name. Input signals A, B and select, and the output signal D out is an identifier for the signal name. And these calls identifiers. This is important to use relative identifier name for each items so that we knows what is for what purpose. If you look at the left side section of your screen, then underlined words are called the keywords. Inside the entity and the end of entity, we have the port list. Inside this port list, we have signal identifier to name our signal. Then we have the port mode to tell whether it's the input or output or the bidirectional signal. And finally, each signal in the port list must be associated with the signal type. Bit is the signal type here. A signal type refers to all the possible values that the signal can have. And signal type bit means that it can have the possible values of 0 and 1. We have several different type of signals in VHDL for declaration, but we will look over them later. Few things you should know about the entity is, VHDL entity defines the interface of our module and lists all inputs and output ports. Second, an entity must be associated with at least one architecture. We will be learning the architecture in some time, but in brief, an architecture is where we define the functionality of our design. To avoid syntax error, the identifier for the original entity name must match while ending the entity with the AND entity name. While defining the last signal in the port list, we must put the ending bracket before the semicolon. So we had little understanding of entity now, where we define the interface of our module. The entity is a separate design unit but will be associated with an architecture, where we are going to describe the functional description of our digital system in terms of behavior or structure or set of concurrent statements. Let's understand the architecture now. We will take the MUX example again. We start the architecture with the statement architecture MUX design of MUX is, here MUX design is the architecture identifier and MUX is the entity identifier which we created in the last slide. This means that architecture MUX design is associated with the entity called MUX. After architecture declaration, we type begin, and from here you can start writing your functional design. This is called architecture body. All the keywords again marked as underlined. In our example of multiplexer, we are giving our functional description in behavioral modeling style, where we can put our statements for sequential execution. For this, we need to use the keyword process. We will have the deeper understanding of this process later, but at this moment, you need to keep a note that if you are describing your architecture in behavior where you need sequential execution, you need to put those into the process body. Process body is everything that you enter inside the process and end process. Here is how we write the process in VHDL. Write process followed by the brackets where you will type all the signal identifiers which are going to be used as an input signal inside the process body. For example, here input A, B and select are going to be used in this process, and any changes in these inputs can change your output, right? So we will write A, B and select separated by the comma inside the bracket of process. Then type begin and start writing the behavior of your digital system. So we written if select is equals to 0, then dout gets the value of input A, else output dout gets the value of input B. Note that every statement need to be terminated with the semicolon. Then type and if and semicolon, showing this the end of our condition. Then type and process followed by the semicolon, that showing this is the end of process. Then type and architecture or architecture identifier followed by the semicolon, that shows that it is the end of architecture. Everything you write between the architecture begin and end architecture is called architecture body. Everything you write between the process begin and end process is called the process body. Important thing to note here is that the statements inside the architecture body executes concurrently, and statements inside the process body execute sequentially. Let's have a quick recall into the architecture syntax which we designed in our last slide. So, architecture in VHDL is the unit where we define the functional description of our digital system. An architecture needs to be associated with a single entity only. Syntax is architecture, architecture name of entity name is, then type begin, and in the last and the architecture with and architecture name and then semicolon. Anything inside the architecture begin and architecture is called the architecture body, where you write your functional description in any modeling style. Let's combine the entity unit and the architecture unit to get our complete VHDL design, and in VHDL language we called it component. This complete design has both the interface description as entity and the behavior description as architecture, and this complete component can be correctly synthesized and place and route into the FPGA. We normally put both the entity unit and the architecture unit in the same file, and we prefer to put the entity before the architecture for easy readability. Today we had the basic idea of VHDL design and understand the entity as interface unit and architecture as behavior description unit and combine them to get a final complete VHDL design of a multiplexer. We use the behavior style because we write the behavior of a function inside the architecture. And when you simulate this VHDL design, you will get the functionality of a multiplexer. And when you synthesize this design, you will get the schematic structure of a multiplexer, which you can test into the FPGA. These everything will be the part of our upcoming sessions. So stay tuned for the upcoming videos and meantime, subscribe to the community. If you found this video helpful, please give it a like and leave a comment below. And don't forget to subscribe for regular updates.